Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again.
Increase in us, we pray, unveil why we're made.
Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives for your joy.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome as we gather together to worship God this morning. So whether you are tuning in for the first time, whether you're regularly here each week, or whether sometimes you can't quite make it at 10:30 on a Sunday, but are watching later on, welcome as we gather as St Wilfrid's Church community to worship God together on this Sunday morning. We're going to just have a moment as we hold our lives before God this morning. So Lord, as we come into your presence to worship you together today, we simply ask your presence with us. We ask that you would bless us and keep us. Lord, we pray that as we worship you, you would be in the midst of us and fill us with your Spirit. So Lord, speak to us that we may hear your word. Move among us that we may behold your beauty, your glory. Receive our prayers that we may learn to trust you. Amen. So as we gather together this morning, let's have a moment as we think, here's my question. What has made you smile this week? What has made you smile this week? Excellent. Look, you see, it worked. We experimented with posting up a question earlier. So let's have a look. What's made you smile this week? Picking up Val from QMC. And that is great news that Val is now home and recovering at home. For Alan, it's been the music as we have worshipped together and our music group and others have put together the worship song. The beautiful views, talking to friends face to face. That has been great and it's been good as we've been out and about in Calverton to see people and to talk to people and to have really good one-to-one conversations. Eating waffles that we brought from the Rodney car park yesterday. Yum. The year ones that I'm now teaching and Brendan laughing. A neighbour's child who has run 3 kilometres a day for 3 weeks and raised over £1,200. That's amazing. That's really brilliant. For Boyd, it was shopping. Catching up with a friend for a walk that I haven't seen for ages in lockdown. And for me as well, I've been able to do that this week. For me as well, yesterday and doing Messy Church. And if you haven't seen our Messy Church service yesterday, we had a wheelbarrow race in the garden. That made me smile. Feeling the sun on our faces and yesterday after a week of rain. Celebrating with our daughter's 30th in the garden, visiting new granddaughter and doing Messy Church and seeing our families. It is good, isn't it, to remind ourselves that actually we have had times when we've smiled, because sometimes, and especially at the moment, life can be tough. And so it's good to remind ourselves of the things that have made us smile this week. And so we're going to turn those smiles into praise. And we're going to have a song of praise with the response on the screen.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of the day.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of the day.
God is our refuge, ready to help whenever we are in trouble.
God, the Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
We will not fear, even if the earth shakes and mountains topple into the sea.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
Come now and look at the works of the Lord, the awesome things he has done on earth.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among nations.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
The Lord is with us. He is our stronghold. God will help at the break of day.
Thank you, Will.
It's as we are reminded that God is with us, that he helps us each and every day, that he is the one that we can cling to and hold on to when we feel as though everything is shifting beneath us. Today we are thinking about God, strangely enough, and thinking about the fact that actually God is there and in our lives and with us. And so we're going to have our readings from Acts and from Luke.
Good morning. The first reading is taken from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 17, beginning to read verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, the Greek council, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' Now what you worship as something unknown, I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands, as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord."
Reading is taken from Luke 4, verses 14 to 21. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this script has been fulfilled hearing." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. So we've had those readings from Acts and from John, where we've experienced listening to things about Jesus and the truth about God. So my question is, I'm wondering why we believe that something or somewhere exists if we've had no experience of it. Why do we believe that those things, those places are really there? If you ask a question of a child about somewhere like Australia that they've maybe never been to, they do believe completely that it exists. And so maybe when we're thinking about why we believe that something or somewhere or someone exists, it's because somebody has told us so convincingly that we believe them. We believe what is written in books. We believe what people tell us. Sometimes dangerously, we believe what's put on Facebook, and maybe we shouldn't. But we believe things because we have been convinced that that is true. And why is that? Why are we convinced that that is true? Well, maybe it's to do with something to do with our hearts and our minds. Maybe it's because we have a longing, a desire to want to believe in something or somewhere. Maybe it's our hearts that are open to that belief. Maybe it's because we trust the person that we're listening to, or the book that we're reading, or the television program that we're watching. Maybe it's because other people around us and other things can ratify the claim that they are making. Well, as I was thinking about this, when I was thinking about what I was going to say, I realised that maybe in all of these reasons, the basic reason that we believe things when people tell us is because within us there is an element of hope into the unknown and beyond kind of our own experience of our world. We want to know the beyond. We want to know more. We want to experience something beyond our own little kind of realm, if you like. And all of those things and more result in us believing stuff, for want of a better word, really. We believe that the colour the sky is called blue, because that's what we're taught as a child. We believe that there is a place called Timbuktu, although I'm not sure many of us have actually ever been. I haven't. But we believe that it is there and it really does exist. So when we're thinking about the things that we believe, I wonder how we tell other people about stuff. How we tell other people about something that we've experienced so that they believe us. We're probably quite happy, quite excited, quite enthusiastic. When they believe us, we're probably quite relieved, ecstatic maybe, kind of thankful, all those things, all those emotions. So yesterday in Messy Church, we were talking about the story of Philip and the Ethiopian. So Philip is there and he's walking along a road and God prompts him, the Holy Spirit prompts him to talk to the man, the Ethiopian man in a carriage who's reading a scroll from Isaiah and doesn't really understand what's going on. As Philip talks to him, he begins to understand, and Philip is using his body and his words to explain the gospel to this man, to the point where they walk, they ride past a river and the man asks to get baptized. He has been convinced by Philip, by the use, Philip's use of words and language, by his heart being open to believe in God. How do we feel if somebody doesn't believe us? What happens when someone doesn't believe what we're trying to convince them of? We get frustrated, we get upset, we get concerned, we get worried. It's not a good feeling, is it, if we know what we're saying is true? It's a really difficult thing. Today we begin a new series, a series that's called Good News People, because that is who we are. We are good news people because we have heard and believed the good news about Jesus. And as we have heard that good news, we are on different journeys on that journey of belief. Some of us are fully believing and living in the love and the hope and the peace that that belief has brought. Some of us are trusting and beginning to trust and understand a little as we explore the Christian life. And others coming along to find out what this Christian thing is and why people believe in God, exploring just like that Ethiopian man. We're called good news people because we live a life in the knowledge that the good news about Jesus coming into the world to bring us back to a place where we can have a relationship with God. A God who loves us unconditionally, who gave his Son that we could know him, who sent the Holy Spirit so that our lives can be renewed and refreshed and lived without fear. The message of God's love and grace and mercy is good news. And that's why we are good news people. Why is it that we believe that? Maybe we believe it because our hearts are open. Because we've been convinced of God's existence through experience and understanding. Through people talking to us. Through reading our Bibles. Through spending time in prayer, maybe. We begin, when we hear the good news about Jesus, to very carefully put our hope and our trust in him. And as we do that, we discover that that God is a trustworthy and a faithful God. So today, as we begin our Good News series, and we're thinking about the fact that there is a God, today is the story when we remind ourselves, in this very different society that we live in at the moment, that God does indeed exist and is at work in our lives and has and will continue to bring blessing out of these terrible times. So the reading in Acts brings us with Paul to a place called Athens. It's the first time in his life that he has gone to this place, and he's heard about it and longed to visit it all of his life. If you can imagine somewhere that you've kind of heard about and want to be and want to experience that place, and kind of when you build it up, don't you, and you build it up to whatever it might be, and then it's not that place. Athens was one of those places that everybody longed to go to experience the people and the culture and the atmosphere. And yet, as Luke so excellently describes, Athens wasn't all that it held out to be. In fact, it was so awful that Paul, it says, was greatly distressed because he saw the worship of idols, and that is all that he saw in this place. The whole city, not just a little bit, but the whole city was given over to the worship of idols, even ones with no name or no idea who they would be. He must have got there and wondered where on earth God was in that. I wonder if we've ever been to in a place like that that's so desolate, we have asked, where is God in all of this? Where is God in this place? We might have been there a few months ago at the beginning of lockdown. We might be there now, a few months on, struggling. We may have been there in the past, and we will certainly almost be there in the future. More likely than not, it won't be a physical place, will it, but an emotional one. When we come to this place and we say, where is God in this? Just as many people in the Bible have done before us. If we read the Psalms are full of David's lament and others' lament as to where God is. But what do we do in that situation? What did Paul do? What did David do? What did Jesus do as he faced the rejection? That subconscious denial of God's experience. What do we do in our lives when we ask the question, where is God in this? Well, if we look at what the people in the Bible did and we listen to what others do and we gain experience from that, we discover a simple thing that they do. They plant their feet firmly on the ground and declare the good news, maybe to themselves and to their hearts, maybe to others. Paul declared the good news to those who would listen in Athens. David declared it to his soul as he sat and wrote his psalms and songs, declaring that wherever he is, however desolate he feels, God is there and God will restore him. Jesus, to those people in Nazareth, declared the good news of who he truly was. When I've been in places where I've wondered where God is, I've simply put my feet on the ground and prayed the creed, declared those words that actually this is what I believe. No matter what's going on around me, deep down, rooted deep down in my heart, is the belief that God is there and God loves me. We hear of so many losing their faith or losing their place in their lives and coming back. Those deep down roots of that God's gritted determination to love us and to keep us in spite of our human woebegoneness, if you like. How do we know that God exists? Because he pulls us out of the mire and he sets our feet on the rock. How do we know that God exists? Because we see him at work in the smallest, in the tiniest of things, in the waffles in the car park and the shopping. And we see him in the biggest of things, in the marriage proposals and in the hugs from family. Each and every day, if we take the time to see, we see God at work. And Paul lived for God, and we see this in his whole story from his conversion. He lived and he moved and he had his being in the God who loved him and who restored him and who forgave him. And so he spoke to those people in Athens with a passion and a commitment. He saw and he observed and he considered the idolatry around him. And he felt the injustice of people that have been created by God giving homage to other things, to made up stuff that just wasn't right. And so he spoke out. Not in a condemning or a judging way, but simply in the truth. He simply spoke Jesus, Christ crucified, the story of God in lives. He told God's story, painted the picture, and allowed the Holy Spirit to come and to convince those whose hearts were open. Who is the God that we believe in? Well, if we take these verses from Paul, he is the one who created the universe. He is the sustainer of life, the ruler of the nations, the one who lives in us and wants to know us, wants to know us. The Father of us all, the judge of the world. He is the one who loves us and redeems us and restores us and wants us to share that love with others. This is the God that we believe in. We are good news people, so let's not be afraid to tell others and to show others. Let's not be afraid to speak of God at work when we see him at work, in the little and in the big. God loves to give us things, delights in blessing us. And so all those things that have made us smile this week are God blessing us in the little things in our lives, giving us the little treats to show us that he loves us. Let's not be afraid to stand up and to speak out for God, whether that's in our actions or in our words, because it's up to God to convince those open hearts that he exists. It's up to him to convict. It's up to him to draw others closer to himself. It's up to us to do what Jesus asked us to do, and to go and to teach and to make disciples. And let's just pause as we hold our lives part of God's story. Jesus, help us to be part of your story. Help us to love and to care for others. Help us to be the good news people that you have made us to be. We know that you exist. We trust in you. We know that you have transformed our lives. And so we pray that you would fill us again with your Spirit. Help us to be those good news people that you have called us to be. Amen. You might like to take a piece of paper or a post-it note or something, or do it afterwards if you haven't got one to hand, and on it write good news people, or I am a good news person. I am a good news person. And put it somewhere on your fridge to remind you that God has equipped you and enabled you to be that good news person. to be part of his story. He has chosen you to be part of his story. And he blesses you with the small things that make you smile. And he gives us strength to get through the things that make us sad and distressed. So do something to remind you on a piece of paper and a note that you are a good news person, whether you are all the way down the journey, on the journey with God, whether you're just beginning and finding out what this Christian thing is all about. We are good news people because that is what God has called us to be. When we wonder whether we believe in him, and when we do believe in him. We're just going to have a moment now, and what we're going to do is going to listen to a poem that Jean has written. So let's just be still and let's just be blessed by these words of the poem.
The poem is called Daughter. Daughter, he calls me daughter. Made new, his spirit within. He is king, king of all creation, and he calls me daughter. To think my father created me and the whole world and everything in it. How can I comprehend such things? But how precious the knowledge those thoughts bring to my heart. For I belong. I have come home. My foundation was formed before the world began. For my foundation is my Lord, my Father, my Saviour, my friend. He calls me daughter.
Lord, in this time of pandemic, it can be easy to feel hopeless and to live in fear or anger at the suspension of what we had come to regard as normal life. Lord, in these challenging times, reveal yourself to us when we are tempted to turn our backs on you. Remind us of Jesus, whose perfect life and work displayed the fullness of God in human flesh. Reassure us that your word is faithful and that you are a good father who cares deeply for humanity. And when our faith is weak and failing, help our unbelief. In the guiding light of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. We pray specifically for those whose lives have been made especially difficult by the coronavirus, particularly those from disadvantaged groups. Give peace to those who have mental health issues. Draw near to those who are facing terminal illness. Help families whose relational difficulties have been sharpened by lockdown. Comfort all who have been bereaved, and especially families whose bereavements have been made harder because they couldn't be with loved ones. In the guiding light of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. We pray for the wisdom for all who are in government at this time. May they lead with humility. Help them as they try to make decisions in the best public interest. We pray for those who are on the front line of medical care. Give insight and creativity to the minds who are working hard to develop treatment and vaccine. Bless their work so that we can resume a life where we are not afraid to hug those we love or to meet for worship and all the other things that enrich our lives. In the guiding light of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. We pray for your world and think especially of people who suffer discrimination, oppression, and deprivation, who are denied the opportunities to achieve their full potential in this and other lands. We pray for the current crisis in the United States, asking that all involved may show wisdom and sensitivity. May all the people of the world be inspired and guided by the unity of the Trinity and its relationships of love. In the guiding light of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thank you that in the fullness of the Trinity we have everything we could ever need. Open our spiritual eyes so that we focus on your character and your mercy. Give us the hope that comes from sins forgiven and the faith to place all our trust in you. Remind us of your power and authority over all things and of the hope and peace that only you can bring. In the guiding light of the Father, Son and Holy Spirit, we pray. Open our hearts, Lord, to the unity that is seen so clearly in the Trinity. May we reflect on the words of this poem based on Psalm 133 as we live our daily lives in our community. How very good and pleasant it is when people live together in unity, when forgiveness oils the wheels of relationships, when kindness is the currency, when understanding is the language that is learned, when issues can be aired and faced honestly, when friendship is nurtured above differences. How very good and pleasant it is when people live together in unity, when food is shared and bread and wine brings us together, when we find in Jesus there is no rich or poor, privileged or marginalised, when hope and peace wash away grudges and the desire to get even. How very good and pleasant it is when people live together in unity. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And so just before we say our final prayer together, we've got our notices. So a reminder that the things that normally happen this week on Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday are on Facebook. And if you don't manage to catch them on Facebook, they're on, we upload them to YouTube, onto our YouTube channel afterwards. We give Year 6 children a Bible each year, the Year 6 children in the village, and if you'd like to contribute and sponsor a Bible, then just let me know and we can sort that out towards their Bibles. We haven't this year, week, well, for the last month, seen what you've been up to. And so it would be great if we could have some pictures in the week to come of things that you have been doing, places that you've been, things that you've been doing, things that you've been reading, just a picture of you maybe that we can then use next week's service. So please try and remember our sticker finger reminder out, but send us a picture of something that you have been doing or something that you will be doing in this week to come. And you will have heard in the news about places of worship being open for private prayer from yesterday. We have got PCC meeting on Monday night, and we'll be talking about at the best way of serving our community with our church and the safest way to do that as well. And of course, in due course, we'll let you know what we're planning on doing. So let's pray together before we meet for coffee at 11:30. So if you want to join us for coffee at 11:30, then join us on Zoom. If you haven't got the meeting ID and the password, then message me and I will let you have it before 11:30. So let's pray together. May God of power, may the boldness of your Spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your Spirit lead us. May the gift of your Spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. Amen.
He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Of God, we will care.